The views and opinions expressed do not necessarily reflect those of Access for Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting groups. If you'd like to produce a show, call us at 260-421-1250.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
We cannot you know, be praising other gods, because we know that the one and only God is our Lord, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank
praise
you.
God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you for that word. At this time, we'll have our praise team come up, and we'll begin our worship. Praise the Lord. I'm going to turn it over to the hands of Lane.
Praise the Lord. Thank everybody for being here. We're going to welcome God into this place right now. Amen.
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 Wes.
So we lift our hands.
Thank you.
Majesty, love the perfect God.
Away my impurities,
I need you to please. 24 verse 15. And around here we help people. If you need help, say help. We'll help you find it.
I'm gonna get some more Bible.
Thank you, Jesus. Joshua chapter 24 verse 15. Thank you, God. And as you find it, please stand for the reading of God's word. We thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Joshua chapter 24, verse 15. Hallelujah. Use me, Lord, in thy service. Draw just help me to stay. way with the Father. Joshua 24:15. But it says, but if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Hallelujah. May God add a blessing to the reading, the hearing, and the doing of his word. You may be seated. Praise God. Excuse me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We know that the Bible is broken down into two parts, the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Old Testament, or the law, gives us instructions on what God desires for us, the commandments on how to live, and the prophecies of what is to come. The New Testament is the fulfilling of the prophecies foretold in the Old Testament. I'm bringing this to us so you can understand the correlation within God's word and how Joshua correlates with the book of Matthew. Hallelujah. In the Old Testament, we read about, in Genesis 15, about Noah. Hallelujah. We know that back then the world was corrupt. They were doing all kinds of things. They were marrying. They were giving in marriage. They was doing everything that was against the word of God. This is in the Old Testament. And during that time, the only one that God saw that was righteous enough for him was Noah. As a matter of fact, the Lord said that he wished he had never created man. That's what he said. He was upset with the fact that he had created us because we weren't living according to his word. We was living according to the world. That's the way it was in the Old Testament. And then with Joshua, you look at what God did. We know about how they went in the wilderness with Moses and how the Israelites were set free. They were wandering in the wilderness for 40 days. All these things happened in the Bible. And then they became corrupt. They started worshiping idols and doing all kinds of things. And we look at Joshua and we look at how God used him after Moses and did what he did, and God called him home. Joshua was the one that was supposed to bring us over to the promised land. We look at his life, and he's also in the Old Testament. And I know you probably said, what's all that got to do with me? Well, let me tell you what it has to do with you. In the Bible, as I stated, it's broken into two parts. The Old Testament, a lot of people, they base their religion on everything that's in the Old Testament, but they don't really look at the New Testament in the context that it is in. In the Old Testament, there was law. And when you broke the law, you had to make a sacrifice. And that sacrifice, if it wasn't accepted by the Lord, sometimes those people died if their sacrifice wasn't accepted. The Old Testament also, as I stated earlier, was the New Testament revealed. The New Testament was the Old Testament revealed. You say, what does that mean? Everything that they talked about in the Old Testament came to pass in the New Testament. All the prophecies of the Old Testament. In this scripture that we just read, where Joshua was talking about, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Well, the Lord hadn't been revealed yet in the Old Testament. So how could he be talking about the Lord and he's still in the Old Testament? How? Because he was one of the prophets of the Old Testament. He prophesied about what was going to come to pass in the New. If we look at our lives today after Jesus, we look at Jesus coming. He didn't come, like I said, to break the old law, to abolish the Old Testament laws. He came to fulfill them. In the Old Testament, we had to make sacrifices. In the New Testament, we didn't have to make any sacrifices because Jesus was the one perfect sacrifice once and for all. No matter what our sins were, no matter what we did, no matter how we lived, Jesus Christ was the one that gave us the opportunity to be free from bondage, free from the hands of the enemy. He was the one. Now, did everybody accept him at first? No, they didn't. Nobody, everybody didn't ones, you know, that was talking about crucifying him. They were out there, they talked about him, they backbited, gossiping, everything else. They was living all kinds of ways, some of them, not all, but some. There was not a lot of holiness. As a matter of fact, the ones that ordered or wanted his death were the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the so-called Christians of the church, the spiritual leaders. They were the ones that stirred up the people to the point where they wanted to crucify Jesus. All of this came to pass. The enemy had them all twisted up and turned around, and their lives was almost being destroyed. But Jesus, he kept his focus on what he was coming to do, and that was to set us free. Amen. He came to set us free, and in his word, that's exactly what he did. Now let's jump up to where we are today. In the world today, we see the same things that we saw in the Old Testament. People living all kinds of ways, yeah, doing all kinds of things. Yeah. There are those out there that's preaching against Jesus Christ. They're saying that he was a good old boy, a prophet. He was not the one that came to set us free. There was all kinds of things going on in the world today. It's almost like they are trying to take the Bible out of our lives. And if we're not careful, that's exactly what's going to happen. You look at the TV shows and all kinds of mess on there. You look at everything that's going around in our communities and all the things that the enemy is making us think that is good for us. And all it's doing is destroying our lives. But Jesus is standing there saying, I sacrificed myself for you. I've given you a choice. You can either go the way that you're going, which will end you in hell, or you can come with me. And you can live the life that I have required and called you to live. Everything that we desire in life, we can get through Jesus Christ. There's not nothing in this life that we want, because see, he wants us to be free. He wants us to have all the blessings that he desires for us. He is the one that gave us the thoughts in our mind of the gifts and the desires of our heart that we want. But the enemy comes in and tries to distort those things and make us feel as if I got to do it this way to get this. And all you're doing is destroying your life, and it's taking time after time after time. The Lord is still standing. If you just let go, if you just come to me, everything you desire in your life, I'll give it to you. Come to me and see what I will do for you. Like I said, he gave a choice. I remember when I was going through a bad situation in my life, I had gotten married, and my husband was not the one that God, I believe he was not ready. See, one thing about it, God gonna say, yes, you can have something, no, you can't have it, or wait. He had told me to wait. He wanted me to wait so I could see whether or not this man was going to be really the man that he desired and required, wanted me to have. But instead of me waiting, I let my mind, I'm getting older, I want to be married, all my friends married, I want a husband. So I went ahead and I got married.
Come on now.
And you know, that was the beginning of 13 years of hell. I went 13 years of hell. And I remember, as I was going down the street and thinking about the abuse that I was going through and the neglect and going through all the bitterness and the pain and all the things, it was like he didn't want me to go to church, so he kept me from going to church, and he didn't want me to be around my friends and my family, so he separated me. You know, that's how abusers do. They'll separate you from the people that will help you and will love you. And he did all these things, and I found myself drinking and doing all kinds of things, trying to get it out of my head. Now, I was a child of God. I was in the church, but all these things was happening, and I'm like, I remember going down Lafayette Street, and God spoke to me. He said, but I was praying, the Lord help me get out of this mess. But see, I didn't believe in divorce. I wanted the Lord to show me that he was with me to get out of this situation. And the Lord said to me, this is plain as I'm talking to you. He said, I've given you a choice. Choose you this day. Because choices are given.
Yes.
But the choice that you choose right now will shape your destiny.
Amen.
So choose wisely. And at that moment right then, I said, God, if you want me to get out of this marriage, then you gonna open that door for me to do so. I read his word. He said, adultery, if you was an adulterer, the things that they're doing is against my word. You are free to do that. I said, well, Lord, I don't have no money. I said, if it's for you to let me out this divorce, I'm gonna go downtown to this courthouse, and you go, I ain't gonna have to pay a dime to get out of this divorce. I went down to the courthouse to file, and my cousin was sitting there. He said, I've been waiting on you for a long time. He said, I'm gonna fill out these papers. You ain't gotta pay a dime. I'm gonna walk them over to the judge, and I'm gonna let the judge know just what's been going on. And I'm gonna let him, after 30 days, he signed those papers. And after he signed those papers, I was free from the enemy. I was free. But you know what? Even though he freed me, I still had a lot of bitterness in my heart. I said, I'm not gonna, he left the house and all that, and I had a lot of bitterness in my heart. And God said, if you don't forgive him, how do you expect me to forgive you? Forgiveness is the hardest thing that you can do when somebody has hurt you. Amen. Forgiveness is the hardest thing that you can deal with when somebody has taken you to a place that you don't want to be in, but they've taken you there by the way they treated you. And I ask the Lord to help me to be able to forgive. Yes. Well, over, for to make a long story short, his life, February of last year, he had his sister call me, and she said, he wants you to come to the hospital because he was in bad shape. Well, the first time that she called, I didn't feel led to go. Because I prayed, and God brought me. I'm going to tell you, I'd be here all day if I told you everything he brought me out of and into the marvelous light, how he forgave me. But first of all, I had to forgive myself for the mistakes that I made. But he helped me to come out of that situation. And when I was in the hospital, they called me the second time, and they said, would you please come? So I drove to where he lived, and I went to the hospital. And he said, I want you to forgive me for everything that I took you through. He said, call your mother and let me tell her that I want her to forgive me. He said, because I know I was wrong, and God has been beating me up ever since. I knew I should have made this call a long time ago, but they told me I don't have long to live, and I want to make it right before I go. His brother pulled me over to the side, and they said he might not make it through the night. So I prayed the prayer of salvation with him, and I told him I had forgiven him, and I meant it from my heart. And that night on my way home, I could feel the weights being lifted off of me, and I heard the Lord say, you are now free. Amen. When I got home, I got the phone call that he had passed, and they wanted me to do his service. I was like, Lord, you pushing me. But I had to do it. And while I was standing there, I didn't talk about what he had done to me. I talked about how God can help you to forgive those who have hurt you. How God can bring you to a level that you never ever thought you could be. How God can take away all the bad things that have happened in your life and turn them around for the good. See, I'm able to stand here and tell you these things because I know God has freed me from the hands of the enemy. And I know that there may be somebody sitting out here that have gone through bad situations, that have gone through abuse, that have gone through neglect, that have been used and abused by the world. And God has let me testify to you that if he did it for me, he'll do it for you. Amen. There is no respect or a person in the Lord. He will set you free. All you want to, you have to do is, first of all, trust him. Believe on him. Become his child. And when you become his child, let me tell you something. A lot of times we preach about becoming the child of the Lord, but we fail to let you know that you're going to need somebody to walk with you. You're going to need somebody to disciple you. You're going to need somebody that you trust, that you can go to, that you can share all your nastiness and your ugliness with, and they're not going to look down upon you for doing it. They're going to pray with you and build you back up.
Yes.
Because you're going to need that. Because, see, this is what happens. When you accept Jesus Christ in your life as your personal Lord and Savior, He has forgiven you. But then you got to first, after that, forgive yourself. You got to get into the Word of God. You got to see all the promises that God has. And then you got to ignore those that's out here that's gossiping and talking about you and saying, oh, you just say, you talking about you a child of God, look what you're doing. You still out here smoking. You still out here drinking. You're still out here just like we are. How can you be a child of God? Because see, one thing for sure, every time we accept Jesus Christ, we got to let go of that past. But sometimes it takes time. It's not going to come right away. Some people it comes immediately. Some people you got to go through some things. You got to allow the Holy Spirit to work with you and talk with you. And you got to pray. You got to be around encouraging people. That's going to eventually help you to let go of some of your past. Because see, you can't do it all at once by yourself. Because the devil is going to make sure that everything that you used to do is going to be right in front of your face. Well, you got to make a choice. Am I going to go back into the world? Am I going to live for Jesus Christ? And do I want the life that He wants for me? Or do I want to stay in the hellhole that Satan has put me in? You got to make a choice. Now it's time for a choice. And you see how the world is today. It takes me back to Noah. When Noah was building that ark, and they laughed at him. Because see, he was building an ark on dry land. It hadn't rained in a long time. And they laughed and talked about him. Oh, you building an ark out here? And there ain't no rain coming? And they laughed and talked about God. And Noah knew what God had told him to do. And he was going to obey God regardless of what the world was saying.
Yes.
We got to obey God regardless of what the world may be saying to you. Because God knows your ending. He knows what He has for you. He knows the plans that He has for you. Plans for you to prosper. Plans for you to be in health. Plans for a great hope and a great future. But you got to get a spiritual backbone. You got to tell the devil, I'm not going to be like I used to be. I may look back, but I'm not going to go back. I may look at the way I used to be, but I'm going to use the ways that I used to be to make me a better person today. You are not going to steal my joy. You are not going to steal my relationship with Jesus Christ. I may get out here, and you may see me stumble. You may see me fall. But one thing about it, God said His grace and His mercy will be with me all my days. The Holy Spirit is with me to guide me, to protect me, to direct me. So Satan, get off my back. It's one thing that we do here in our church when the devil tries to come against us. With a little song that we sing, and we want to teach it to all of y'all. It says, shake, shake, shake. Shake the devil off. Shake, shake, shake. Shake the devil off. Shake, shake, shake. Shake the devil off. In the name of Jesus. Shake the devil off. Whenever he comes and gets in your face, and you know that you're trying to live right, but it seems like he's there, you're going to have to shake him off. Because see, once you got to know that when you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, He is the one that's living inside of you. Light and darkness can't live in the same place. You are now His child. You are now covered by His blood. That all the host of angels in heaven are now at your beck and call. All you got to do is say, Jesus, help! And He will send the help that you need to strengthen you and help you to get through whatever the situation is that you're going through. Don't let the devil get in your ear and tell you, oh, you're the same. Oh, you're not I want you to know this. And you know what? I'm going to share this with you. I had prepared a different sermon. God is speaking to you today.
Yes.
God wants you to know that he loves you no matter what you've done in your life. He loves you. He is the one that is your protector. He is the one that is your comforter. He is the one to bring you the joy. He is the one that will bring you your peace.
Yeah.
He is the one that is your deliverer. He is the one that will war for you. He said, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. In the end, I will repay. He is the one that will be here for you.
Yeah.
All you have to do is trust and believe and obey. The obedience is being just like the Bible talked about David being a man after God's own heart. David loved the Lord. Did David mess up? Sure did. He got Bathsheba pregnant. He killed Uriah, her husband. He did things that he wasn't supposed to do. Yet God said he was a man after his own heart. How could that be? David recognized when he made a mistake and he asked for forgiveness. He recognized when he was not living the way that he should live. And he asked God to please forgive me. Don't you know that Jesus Christ came through the lineage of David? He came through a murderer. He came through an adulterer. He came through all of those things. He came through it. And you know what? When he came through, Jesus let us know. And if you read the story of his life, through the life of Jesus Christ, everything that we've gone through, he's gone through it.
Yes.
Everything that we say we are dealing with, he's had to deal with it. He said, I'm 100% man and I'm 100% God.
Amen.
Why was he like that? Because he did not want us to think that there's anything that we've gone through in life that he don't understand. He wants us to know that I've been through the pain. I've been through the troubles. I've been through the backbiting. I've been through the gossiping. I've been through the lies. I've been through deception. I've been through it all.
Yeah.
I've been through health problems. I've been through it all.
Yeah.
There's nothing that you haven't gone through that I have not been through. And because I've been through it, I can help you go through it.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
We got to trust the God that we serve.
Yes.
We got to believe in the God that we serve.
Yes.
Don't let nobody put you down. Everybody here has a gift. Everybody here has a talent.
Yes.
I'm not like you. You're not like me. But there's something that God has instilled in you that the enemy does not want to let you go to do. And because of that, the enemy tries to keep you down.
Yes.
But you need to look within yourself. Get in the mirror every day and say, I am better than the world may think I am. I'm better than everybody. I'm even better than I think of myself. Because God is going to build me up to be what he requires.
Yes.
And what he desires of me.
Hallelujah.
Because he loves me. And it's something else we did a couple Sundays ago. I want us to stand and do this in the name of Jesus. I want you to stand and wrap your arms around yourself. Because see, sometimes we have to encourage ourselves. Sometimes we have to show ourselves love. Sometimes we are in situations where everybody else don't seem like they love us. Sometimes we gotta hug ourselves and we gotta sing this little song to ourselves. Yes, Jesus loves me in spite of everything. Yes, Jesus loves me. He loves you. Put that in your mind. Yes, Jesus loves me. For the Bible tells me so. Now look at your neighbor and tell them, yes, Jesus. Yeah. spite of ourselves, he loves us. Do we make mistakes? Yes. But guess what? He loves us. Do we sometimes disappoint him and ourselves? Yes. But guess what? He loves us. No matter what we do, no matter where we come from, no matter how situations have been, they've been hard. Like I said, I'd be up here all day, and I'm sure some of you have testimonies of what has gone on in your life. But if you think about it, what has God done to help you to get to a better place today than you were yesterday? What has he done to help you to be all he wants you to be? So when we go home and we look in that mirror every day, you need to say, I am everything God says I am.
Yes.
I am loved by the Most High God.
Yes.
No weapon formed against me shall prosper. I will be all he has called me to be. I will do all he has called me to do. I will live the life that he has called me to live because I'm his child.
Yes.
I am his child. I am his child.
Yes.
And yes, Jesus loves me. Yes. In Jesus' name, I thank you. Diane has a song, and then we're going to end. We got another song that's coming out. What's the name of what we're going to do? Every praise. We're going to sing that together, and Wes will let every praise be the ending. Before she comes, and I normally don't do this, but this is the second time you've mentioned this to me. Does anybody have a testimony of the goodness of the Lord that you want to share? Anybody? I don't care who it is, yes.
You know, Sandy Gee, her testimony, just by God divine appointment, 10 years ago probably,
mm-hmm.
15 years ago, I met Sandy at a meeting.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't let neither one of us know, and here I end up actually right here with you.
Praise God.
It's just all a divine appointment. But I've been through something similar to what Sandy has been through. And I can tell you, God has delivered me from every doggone
Amen.
Thing that tried to beset me.
Amen.
The enemy wanted to take me out in the game. And you know, I'm still standing here, and
Amen.
I'm having joy of my life. What God says, he loves us. He's going to be there for us. And you know what? If you just trust him, he
yes.
said he is love. I just want to love on you, but he won't force himself
yeah.
on you.
No.
All you have to do is say, will you come in, Jesus?
Amen.
I want you to love on me. And I did that, and the Lord just renewed me and renewed my life.
Praise
and
God.
I've gone through some struggles. I'm still going through it. But you know what? You'd never know it because I got the love of the Lord and the joy of the
Lord. Amen. Praise God. Anyone else? Anyone else?
Let's
yes.
make it short, Sandy. I've been through a lot in my life. Many things that really, really haunted me in my life. I let them carry through. For a long period of time, I always wanted to be in control. And there was always anger in my life against people doing things that were wrong to my family, to my kids, whatever it may be. Several years ago, there were a bunch of kids from New Haven that were allowed to deliver drugs to the community, to other kids, to other people. And I went to the New Haven Police Department about it, and it was ignored. Well, I found out that New Haven was running the drug house. I was very distraught. I called a friend that I knew on the New Haven Police Department. They wouldn't do anything about it. And then I knew. He knew everything that was in that house, just like my son had told me. He had been in there by accident. And that was kind of a header in my life. I couldn't take it anymore. My son had basically, you know, turned to me and said, Dad, what I've seen is awful. I said, yeah, I know, son. I said, I've seen a lot of the same things when I was younger. My cousin died because of drugs. I had a cousin that wound up in the Michigan State Penitentiary because of drugs. Things were not easy, but God helped me overcome those things.
Amen.
The one thing that really stood out in the whole thing during that period of time, slightly after the thing with the drugs in New Haven, was struggling with my middle son, Curtis. He's a big kid. He played basketball. He had a chance to have a wonderful scholarship to play basketball somewhere. Well, the coach robbed him of that very chance. And I was angry. I was mad. I was distraught. I didn't know what to do. But one day God said to me, he said, I'm telling you, you are fighting the fight, and it's my fight. I will take care of the things that you think you can control. You cannot control. I am in control.
Amen.
I said, okay, God. Well, I was out back, and the chimes started to ring. And the minute they rang, Twister came into my head. I've loved studying tornadoes my entire life. There's something of nature that is unbelievable. I watched my adrenaline jump. I like power. Well, God showed me what kind of power he has. He said, Larry, I'm going to tell you. I'm preparing you to set things in your home. Pick the big rock up, set it here. Put everything in place like I tell you, because there's going to be a storm tomorrow. A big storm. And I'm going to show you what I can do. You know what I do? I just walk around and I did what he told me. And you know, the next day, it was in November, late November, approximately 5-6 years ago, that storm, her tornado, well, I said, my dad and mom called and asked if they could come over because we have a basement. I said, sure. Well, I was standing there, and I said, it's going to be just to the south of us, which it was, but we're going to feel some strong shear winds off the side of that tornado, and it's going to be really strong. So I stood and looked out the window. Instead of taking cover, I wanted to see what God had wanted me to see. Well, we were standing there. Everybody else was prepared to go downstairs, and I'm standing there watching. A wave of wind comes through, which, I don't know, 60, 70 miles an hour. And then there was a dead calm for just literally seconds. And Dad says, I think it's over. I said, no, it's not. I said, here comes the wind. It came through like a freight train. I mean, it was so powerful. It landed on, destroyed a cop's house on the corner. Destroyed people that were evil in that neighborhood, right only down my street. That is about as powerful as I can even believe of anyone happening. Many of my own preachers did not believe me. I showed them everything. The one wonderful thing that I did not notice when I was doing it is I laid two great big pieces of native timber. These are pieces of wood that probably weigh 250 to 300 pounds a piece. I laid them across the swing set, but it was in the shape of a cross. I looked at that all after that, and I said, I understand, God. You are the supreme. You are the power, and I have to stand down and watch you take care of it.
Amen.
You worry about what I want for you.
Amen.
And I will take care of God.
Amen. He will be there in our lives. Praise God. One more. Anybody else? Praise God. Go ahead.
Mine is brief. My testimony pretty much is pretty much how it would be as an individual. You know, years ago, my temper was short. I used a lot of profanity. And God changed me. I allowed myself to be surrounded by negativity. And I indulged in different things, and you know, things was not going positive in my life, and I kept bumping my head and kept asking, why is this happening to me? You know, people around me were prospering, so I kept running from the Lord. He was always there, but I kept saying, I'm going to go to church, I'm going to do this, and years went by, and something else happened, and I kept thinking, I'm doing this. I'm the reason I wake up in the morning. I'm going to take care of this. And then I had a tragedy come into my life, and it made me look at life totally different. I got on my knees, and I cried, and I asked the Lord to come in and help me, save me, make me a better person, you know, change the way I walk, change the way I talk. Put me around positive people that know the Lord. And I sit there a lot of times doubting life and God, like, you know, this has happened to me. There ain't no God. If there was God, why am I going through this? Why is my perch, the one I love, gone? When I finally accepted Christ in my life and stopped running from him, because he was never running from me, that's when everything changed. I mean, seriously, I was able to look at myself and people around me that knew me could see change in me, okay? And that's my testimony. I actually self-changed. I said, Lord, take the cuss words out of my mouth. You know, help me hunger. Take this weed taste out of my lips. You know, help me get some of this alcohol that I crave out of my system. And it was a struggle. And it's day by day, step by step. There's not one time that I'm not tempted. But I know that he has brought me through. The most greatest joy in life is he loved me. And if I don't have no one else in this world, I have the Lord. He don't judge me. And you know, he's brought me to where I'm at now. Because I love the Lord. I'm telling you, I don't wake me up in the morning. He wake me up. And anything that's going through my day that is difficult, I can fix it. Because the Lord's given me the tools. So I know if he can do it for me, he's real. For anybody sitting here to have doubt, God is so real.
Amen.
He will give you joy when you can't find joy.
Amen.
And it's not all about the material and the money and a man and a woman that a man might think you need. You need yourself. Make yourself happy, and then you allow happiness to come into your life.
Amen. Praise God. I said earlier that I want the Holy Spirit to order this service today, and trust me, he's doing it.
Amen.
He's doing it. He's doing it. We'll let you, and you'll be the last one.
Oh, okay. Mine's just short. So I had the enemy try to attack me all this week. By Monday, I got to work, and my back tire was flat. I couldn't drive it, so I had to get it towed to the house. Then on Tuesday, my boss comes and tells me that I have a tire flat, and I'm like, well, I can't be, because I got a tire flat on Monday. And I got a fix. Well, go out to the car, and then now another tire is flat on the same side. So I'm like, okay, you know. So I get the tire fixed. Well, Wednesday, I wake up in the morning to go to work. I fell all the way down my back stairs. So, like, wow, like, my ankle is twisted and everything. Like, I'm in bad shape. But I still went to work on Thursday. I don't think nothing happened. But Friday morning, I woke up to noises in my house, like, 4 in the morning. I go down. There's a strange woman in my room. Don't know how she got there. She don't know how she got there. We don't know how she got there. I mean, she was, after a while, we found out that she was drugged at a bar, and she just wandered into wherever, obviously my house, and there she was. Saturday, I fell on my back porch. So when I tell you, like, I feel like the enemy really has been beating me down this week. If it's not one thing, it's another. But I pray, and I pray with my husband. And when I get up in the morning, it's like a weight. Like, you can feel everything just being lifted. Even the thought of me going to work, I'm going to get ready for church. I have, like, my cousin and my daughter and my son. I'm getting everybody ready. But then in my head, he's like, just be calm. You're fine. You don't have to worry about it. Everything's going to be okay. And I feel grateful. I feel like everything that's happened to me this week, just to be here on Sunday and wake up and see everybody here, it's all justified and it's all worth it. It's all by the grace of God. So,
amen. That's my miracle. I'm standing there. And that's my great-grandson, miracle, that is being held. God brought him here. He was a preemie. God brought him here after my granddaughter had several, when I say several, I mean several miscarriages. We never thought that she would ever have a child. But God gave her a vision, gave her husband a vision, that he was standing there, and this baby was there. And her husband walked in the room and said, you gonna name the baby? And she said, what you mean, what baby? And she looked over, she said she saw Jesus. And he said, Maximus. And Maximus means the greatest, the greatest. So he has given us the greatest gift that this family could have. We don't know if you're ever blessed with another one. But her prayer was, Lord, I just want to be a mother to my own child. And he allowed that to happen.
Amen.
And I thank God for the miracle that we have. So all things are possible if we believe.
Yes.
And at this time, if you are in a situation in your life where you've been beat down, you've been told, you've been broken, you've been told that you'll never be nothing, you'll never be about nothing, and you haven't accepted the Lord as your personal Lord and Savior, and you want to make a change, the altar is open for you. You want to come on and sing? If that's you, we want you to come. Don't be afraid. If there's those around you that's already saved, ask somebody, do you want me to walk with you? And bring them up to the altar so that we can pray. If you're in a situation where you know the Lord, but you're going through some things, and you just need prayer, the altar is open for you. As Diane sings.
Well, Sandy said this was not planned. I was sitting there and listening, and the Holy Spirit spoke to me. And there was a song, The Sinner's Prayer. And as she said, anyone that feels the urge to come forward and be prayed over, please don't hesitate, because we are here to pray over you. And we are here to bring peace to your life. So as I sing The Sinner's Prayer, please come forward if you feel the need. You've done in your past, you know, he forgets us all. You are covered by the blood of Jesus. So if you ever need someone to pray with, you get in touch with somebody here, and we will make sure that you have someone to pray with and someone to walk with. Thank you.
We can have the praise team and come on back to the last song. And we want you all to know that the message today is for each and every one of us. There's nothing that any one person should say. Well, she's talking about me. No, we're letting the Holy Spirit have his way. And it's everybody in here. The word is for all of us, regardless of where we are with our stand with the Lord. Praise God. I guess I'll stand in for Tatiana. She got sick.
Staring into your eyes makes my heart come alive. Suddenly brought to life when I met you. Reaching beyond the skies, running deep, stretching wide. Perfect love realized here with you. Now this love is for real, you will never let go, never let go. Just words, love beyond my control, out of control. This is real love, this is real love. This is real love, this is real love.
This is a fun song that we like to sing.
This, if you will all stand with us, this is our closing song.
Every praise belong to God, amen.
Amen.
Every prayer.
Now I want to heaven who was able to keep you from falling and to prevent you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Let every heart say,
Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.